We are very, very happy to have Dr. Stark to give us in-person lecture regarding drone safety and how to fly legally, or what to observe, and how you can make sure you will get $1 million liability coverage. So all these questions will be answered.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your time.
Okay. Oh. So, my name is Dr. Brandon Stark. I am the director of the University of California Center of Excellence on Unmanned Aircraft System Safety. I'm actually the director of drones for all of the UC campuses, which means all of our drones down in San Diego, to Berkeley, to Davis, to Merced, I have safety management over, which is a lot of drones. There's about 400 to 500 drones in the UC system. About 100 or so are right here at UC Merced. So it's kind of a big program, and it's growing every day. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about drone regulations, about how we fly drones in the UC system. I do have a web page that has a lot of information, uassafety.ucmerced.edu. But we also have a bigger UC system-wide web page. You click on that logo right there. That web page address is a little bit long, ucop.edu/Enterprise Risk Management/Centers of Excellence, it goes on for like a page and a half. So I usually just tell everyone uassafety.ucmerced.edu, and then you can find the bigger UCOP website. So within the UC system, we do have kind of a standardized process for flying drones in the UC system. We do have kind of an online requesting system where you say, hey, I want to fly a drone, and we get a chance, the campus gets a chance to review it to make sure that you have all the drone licenses, all the authorizations, and you're not about to go fly over someone else's soccer practice and things like that. It's a bit complicated, but we kind of simplify it in this kind of a flow right here. Where if you want to fly a drone, we need to do a quick risk assessment, coordinate with the FAA, or other campus units, and then we can fly a drone, and then we need to keep our records. But how we go about this process is kind of complex, because there are, within the UC system, we fall under 47 different permutations of regulatory statutes that we need to follow to fly a drone. And not very many people know more than two or three. And the laws keep on changing. In fact, the laws just changed on Friday. Did anyone catch that news release?
Drone registry thing?
Yes.
Yeah,
so
new. I read that on
Mm-hmm. Yep. Just happened on Friday. The court struck down a regulation that the FAA put into place, and now it's changed things. It only affects recreational drone usage, which only affects student clubs and individual recreational users on our campuses. But these things keep on happening, and they change so rapidly. So behind the scenes, we have four major different types of UAS regulations that we fall under when we try to fly a drone for the UC system. There's a recreational set of regulations. You have the new 107 regulations for small unmanned aircraft systems. We have an older section 333 exemption process, and we'll talk a little bit about that, but not too much. It's not used very often. Public agencies have their own set of drone regulations as well that the UC system falls under. So UAS regulations gets even more complex. Now I'm not going to go into all of the details. You'll have plenty of time to study all of those details, especially if you want to get your drone license examined. So I'm just going to go over a quick overview on some of the drone regulations and then transition that one to drone safety and operations. I know this is all the boring stuff. I'm going over laws. You just want to go out and fly a drone, and I don't blame you. We just picked up a Mavic Pro, and it's pretty fun to fly. And we also have a DJI Inspire. I've got a Bebop, does flips, all sorts of fun stuff. And then this class just got the Intel Arrows, which are a brand new drone from Intel that everyone should be really excited to play with. So the most common question that we get asked in my center is, what is a drone and what is a model aircraft? Congress decided to put into law that model aircrafts are actually a subset of drones. And it's only differentiated by the purpose in which they're flown. So all aircrafts Here's all the aircrafts. Unmanned aircrafts are all a subset of regular aircrafts. Small unmanned aircrafts are a subset of unmanned aircrafts. Model aircrafts are also a subset of unmanned aircrafts, only differentiated by the fact that a model aircraft is flown for fun or for recreation. If you're not flying an aircraft for fun or for recreation, then it's actually an unmanned aircraft. And then you have to follow the unmanned aircraft regulations. This is codified by Congress in 2012. And I'll talk a little bit about that interplay between Congress and the FAA. It's an interesting challenge politically. The most common drone regulations there are is going to be the ones that just came out last August, called 14 CFR 107. And this is the drone regulations for all non-recreational usage. They introduced a new drone license. So you can actually go get a drone license, and then you're legally allowed to fly a drone for any non-recreational purposes, as long as you follow the rest of the regulations. It says in law you can't fly for any careless or reckless operations. You'd think that'd be common sense, but common sense is very not common, especially when it comes to drones that are more or less just giant toys. Our small unmanned aircraft system regulations fall under, your drone has to be under 55 pounds, and you can't fly more than 100 miles an hour. Now, 55 pounds is a big, big drone. I mean, you'd be surprised at how big a 55-pound drone is. Dr. Chen, did you show any pictures of drones in your previous slides?
Yes, drone history.
Drone history, okay, you went over that one. I didn't bring any of my drones with me.
They will have a lot.
Okay, yeah. Did you show any pictures of like the Phantoms?
No.
No Phantoms? So a DJI Phantom is probably one of the more common drones. It's about this big, about this, roughly the size of a basketball. That weighs 4.4 pounds. We have a DJI Inspire that's about this big. That weighs about 7-8 pounds. Dr. Veers has a S-1000 drone. It has about this big. Propellers are 28 inches in diameter. Anyone want to guess how much that weighs?
15 pounds.
So imagine how big the propellers are for a 55-pound drone. 12 feet. You can get RMAXs that are under 55 pounds that have a propeller, a giant rotor, that are 12 feet in diameter. And all you need to do is get your drone license to fly that thing. So 55 pounds is kind of a big drone. And this is one of the challenges with our drone regulations, is that drones come in all shapes and sizes, and they vary significantly when it comes to how dangerous they are. You can only fly during daylight and within visual line of sight. Visual line of sight means that you can see the drone and that you can see which direction the drone is facing. You can't just see it as a speck in the sky. You need to actually see how it's flying in order for it to count as visual line of sight. You are never allowed to fly over people. You are not allowed to fly over people ever. Now, it's probably one of the most commonly violated drone regulations, because everyone does it, but it's actually illegal. It's illegal for not only for our commercial drone operations, but for all the recreational drone operations. If you're flying for fun, you're still legally not allowed to be flying over people. If you're flying near an airport, you do need to have prior airport authorization. So we're literally right next to an airport. You are not allowed to fly in this parking lot unless you have prior authorization from the FAA. And that's why we have cages, and that's why we have the cage in the backyard. So if you're within that cage, you can fly without airport authorization.
You mentioned that we got a blanket authorization.
We have blanket authorizations for a number of locations, none of which are this parking lot.
Okay.
All right. No flying in this parking lot.
Okay.
There are some records of flights that we need to be keeping every time we do go out and fly. But some of these regulations can be waived on a case-by-case basis. You can petition the FAA to fly a number or to ask them to waive some of these regulations. You can ask the FAA to allow you to fly over people. CNN has an authorization to fly over people with their foam kite, actually. It's not really a drone. It's actually just a powered kite that's made out of foam. And they're allowed to fly that over people. And there's a lot of other challenges here. But getting the drone license actually is not that bad. So you can get your drone license. It's your civil license for all non-recreational purposes, which includes recreation, promotional activity for nonprofits, nearly for all UC purposes. It kind of looks like this. You can get these. You have to take a knowledge test at a FAA testing center. The closest testing center here is down the street. I mean, it's literally down the street. It is, as you drove up a hospital road, there's a blue building on the right that says Sierra Air Simulator Testing Center. That's where you go take your drone license test. It is absolutely close. We are, the UC Merced is the, actually not the closest university to an airport testing center. The testing center at Santa Barbara is about a 5-minute block from their main campus, or a 5-minute walk from their main campus. But we're pretty close. It's just down the road. It sucks if you're in Berkeley because their closest testing center is about 25 miles away from Berkeley. So to get your drone license, you just need to take a test. It's a $150 exam. It's a 2-hour exam. It's kind of like taking the written portion of your driver's license exam. If you remember that, they gave you this sheet of paper, a couple of weird questions asking you, do you need to turn on your signal between 200 feet, 250 feet, or 300 feet before an intersection? You remember those crazy questions like that? That's exactly what this drone license test is about.